Hi, and welcome to the 50th episode of the Photoshop Show. Unfortunately, tonight Jan is off teaching and doing her other real work, and I have a suspicion she's going to be watching a bit of the show tonight, but she won't be able to join us. So I'm taking the driver's seat. Tonight we have our guest, Kerry-Ann Lecky Hepburn, but she says we can call her Kerry, which I'm glad of, because I won't be able to say that twice. I got through it once. And she's going to talk to us all about astrophotography, deep space photography, shooting stars with a 35mm camera, among other things. But before we get to that, I just want to do a quick introduction of the panel. And I'd like to introduce you to, probably no stranger to most of you, Daryl Van Gogh. Hi, Daryl.
How you doing, Ron? Thanks. I appreciate you for the invite for this.
Okay.
Just a quick one on myself. Auto worker by day, and by night, I spend most of my time with the digital camera. I do a little bit of deep space imaging, but I've been more concentrating on wide field astrophotography or landscape astrophotography. So, pretty much covers me. Had a couple images do rather well. I had one made it on the NASA site, so I was pretty happy about that.
Yeah, I have to say is I don't do a lot of astrophotography. I do a lot of night photography. I shoot a lot of work in the city and landscape work. And urban work, but I don't do a lot of star photography because I'm really anxious to hear from, well, both of you really, but just anxious to do that and then get out and shoot more star work. I have done some, but I want to learn how to do it really successfully like you guys do. And Dave, our producer, he's the guy, I got to tell you guys a little bit about Dave because he's quiet a lot of the times. Dave is the guy in the background that makes sure that when everything falls apart, he doesn't. And he makes sure that everything gets going. So thanks, Dave.
Oh, it's always great to be here. My day job is teaching information systems courses at a little college in the Napa Valley in California. And but passion for photography, and also really want to learn more about the night photography here. I mainly do landscapes, and just always fun to learn new things.
Yeah. I have to say I've been watching Dave for a while now. We met a couple of years back now, and it's wonderful to watch somebody's photography evolve. And Dave, I saw a post that you posted recently of a photo shoot with the fences and the shed barn, and it's just wonderful, just amazing work you're doing lately. So I just
when we were at the castle. Yeah. And if any of you ever get to the Napa Valley, you'll want to stop by the Castello di Amoroso, which is our very own authentically built castle, which is a new castle that looks old, but he used all the original, hand planed materials. And anyway, it was a great time shooting there.
And then we've got Erica. How are you doing tonight, Erica? You're a little bit quiet, so you might just want to talk a bit louder.
I'm good. Okay, so I'm based out of San Diego, and I shoot right until it gets dark, and then I stop. So I do some pretty cool silhouette stuff, and I do underwater stuff, and I'm based out of San Diego, which I said before. I also have 3 children running in the background without a husband home. So if I sneak out, there'll be a reason for it, but I'll try and sneak back in as much as possible. So I apologize for that distraction, and I'm absolutely thrilled to be here tonight and to learn everything I possibly can.
Great, yeah. And Kerry, we met at a presentation you gave at our local observatory. We have this I guess it's pretty much an antique observatory now, but it's still got this great old telescope, and they give presentations. And we met there, and you gave this presentation that just I couldn't believe. I couldn't believe the images I saw and how you came to have this little setup in an area that's not actually really super dark.
Yeah,
which
no.
Which surprised me, because we hear all about these people going to these ultra-dark locations to get all their work. So I was overjoyed when you said you'd come to the show, and it's taken a while to get you here, but now you're here. So tell us just a little bit about what you do, and then whenever you're ready, break right into your images and then your demonstration, and we'll bring questions to you from the chat, in the comment sections. Feel free to ask questions, and we'll bring them in and hopefully get all of them answered.
Yeah, sure. Well, first of all, I'm just really excited to be on the show. I found Google Plus maybe less than a year ago and stumbled across the Photoshop show, and I started watching episodes here and there. So I just really never imagined that I'd be here doing a demonstration. So it's pretty wild. So my day job, I'm a meteorologist. I work for the Weather Network. It's like the Weather Channel, like what the United States has. The thing is, I work in the background, so I prepare the local forecast. So I don't really get on the camera that much, so I tried to avoid it, so I'm a little bit nervous.
Well, this is going to get you ready for when they call you up to the big
one. Yeah, exactly. Right? I always try to come up with some excuse why I can't do a live interview or something like that. So so anyways, so I do my meteorology. I'm a shift worker. And basically my hobby is, I mean, other than my family, of course, I've got two little girls and a husband. I love photography, all kinds of photography. I've been doing it since I was a little girl, and a teenager. And daytime and nighttime photography, it doesn't matter. But I've always kind of had a special love for night sky, deep sky astrophotography.
Great. That's awesome. You shared, and you'll probably share more later, but you live in an area that's not a dark sky area. Now, you like to go to areas when you can that are darker.
Yeah, if I can.
Yeah, but you still do a lot of work right from your own backyard. You have a setup that's just really quite unique. It's really amazing.
Yeah.
So that's a really fortunate thing, and the fact that you're going to be able to share as you go that a lot of what you do is done in an area that's not considered a dark sky area.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking too. A lot of night sky shots you see are done from areas that are really dark, and not a lot of us have those dark skies. And the thing too is not a lot of people have the time or the opportunity to go to really dark sky locations. So I'm basically going to share my work. There's so much to share on the subject of astrophotography. I could go on for so long about this, but I know we don't have forever to talk about it. So I'm going to try to put everything all into a slideshow. I'm going to try to cover as much as possible. I'm going to start from the beginning, how I got started, and go through my my setup over the years, and so you can see, kind of get a little bit of a background. And then after that, I'll kind of go through some of my workflow and give you a demonstration on my processing technique.
Great, that's awesome.
Okay, so do you want me to start now?
I sure do. Go ahead and do screen share. And
yes. Yeah. Okay, let's go.
If you talk to me and I don't answer right away, it's because I'm muted and I have to find the unmute.
Okay, no problem. And feel free to ask questions as I go along as well. It'll be nice interaction. Okay, I'm going to start the screen share.
Great.
Okay, so here we go. This is my first telescope. And as you can see right now, my kids use it as a toy post. But I received this telescope when I was around 11 years old. And from this, I basically wanted to learn a lot about astronomy. I just thought it was so fascinating, especially around this time. Halley's Comet was basically, in the news. And I really didn't understand anything about how to view objects. But I just knew that, I figured I needed a telescope. And, I just wanted to point it at the sky and see what I could get. And later on, in high school now, this was grade 10, I started a photography class. And this was my first camera, film camera. And that's when I started to really get interested in photography. Attached to this, I don't know if you see my mouse, but this is a camera adapter. And I bought this because I wanted to see what would happen if I hooked up my camera, this film camera, to the telescope that you just saw in the previous slide. And so I did, and this was one of my first shots. And you can see it's a lunar eclipse, not very focused, and the exposure is a little bit weird. It was definitely a challenge with film photography because I didn't really know what kind of exposures to use. It was very much a trial and error sort of thing.
Start with digital photography when you're first starting out to shoot the moon. It's a lot brighter than you think it is.
Yeah. So then after a lot of trial and error, here was my next shot of the moon. So I was so much happier to see that kind of a result. And the thing, too, I noticed with film is you actually can see color on the moon. And it's hard to see that when you're just taking taking digital photos of the moon. And then I just continued to experiment. And in university, I became a volunteer at the observatory. And again, they had a 16-inch telescope there. And I began to think about photography through there. So that same SLR camera, I hooked up to that telescope and I started to take some pictures. And again, I didn't really know what kind of exposures to use. I kind of guessed at it and I figure, you know, if it's a really dark object, then I probably need a long exposure. So this was probably 4 minutes. But on this particular target, if I did 4 minutes, it would have been completely washed out. But with film, it's a little bit easier to take longer exposures. And, of course, I didn't have access to the telescope all the time, so I started to experiment with some tripod images. So this is Comet Hale-Bopp. I don't know if any of you guys remember this comet, but it was so bright in the sky.
Yeah, I remember it.
Wasn't there a cult involved in that that had interesting beliefs about it?
Yeah, probably. Yeah. So that was my probably like a 20-second image of it with the film camera on a tripod. So I was pretty excited about this, and I started to realize, you know, you don't always need to have a telescope to take pictures of the night sky. And with this shot now, this was taken from home in Southern Ontario, and this was when I first started to get into digital photography. So this was my first DSLR. It was the Canon 300D, and this shot just really excited me because, you know, it was a lot clearer, more crisp, and I got instant results, too, because I didn't have to wait to get it developed. I didn't have to worry about the people developing my picture, cutting the roll halfway through my shots because they can't see that anything is even on there, if you know what I mean. So this is what really got me kick-started into getting more serious into astrophotography. And this here is my first real telescope. After my daughter was born and things kind of got settled down with motherhood, I decided to start getting into more astronomy-related stuff. And then I figure with this kind of a setup, I can then adapt it to astrophotography. So here is my first shot through that telescope with my Canon 300D. So the focal length of that telescope that you saw is about 1,500 millimeters. So if you can imagine, pretty big lens.
But
yep.
That's images with the crop sensor as well, correct?
Oh, yeah.
Yes, that's the 300D crop sensor. Exactly. So if it was a full frame, then it would be a little bit smaller. The moon would look a little smaller. And I just decided to test out a lot of images, a lot of targets, even Saturn. And this was when I started to realize that, you know, DSLRs are probably not the best thing to use for planets because planets are so small. And our atmosphere is very wavy and warbly, so you need really good seeing conditions. And the best way to kind of maximize on those conditions is to basically do a video, and the Canon 300D didn't have those capabilities. So, but this was, you know, I gave this a good shot, and this was the best that I could get from it. But I kind of realized that, you know, planetary photography was not going to be my thing, at least not for the time being. And this image here, I was really proud of because it was my very first galaxy, shot. And the thing is, I learned a lot online through this website called cloudynights.com. They have a forum. And everyone kept talking about stacking. you know, you got to stack your images in order to get better signal to noise ratio. And I didn't quite know how to do that. So I basically took two shots of this galaxy and stacked them in Photoshop the best I could. I lined them up manually. And I think I put this in screen mode, so it was just really bright. I really didn't understand. And of course you can see like the pixels here, the dead pixels that are kind of, you know, off, a little bit off, so you can tell. Anyway, so it's not, it doesn't look too great, but you know, at the time it was pretty exciting to actually see a real like galaxy on my frame.
Yeah. Is that a single shot? Did you say?
It's two shots that I I combined. I lined up in Photoshop to the best of my abilities.
It's awesome for a first time.
Yeah, very manual, and I didn't know anything about stacking at the time. So now here's my setup. People, you know, they joked around and said, "Oh, Kerry and her portable astrophotography setup, her portable astro office." So I basically tried to learn as much as I could, and I went to dark sky sites because I really thought that the only way to get good pictures is probably to go to a really dark location. I went to star parties. There's one called Starfest in Mount Forest in Ontario, and you can see my tent there. I've got my laptop, and I'm just ready for a night of taking photos. And basically, I was shooting through this large telescope here, and occasionally I would even use my smaller telescope. This is an 80 millimeter refractor, and the focal length of it is 500 millimeters. The thing is, when I started astrophotography, I didn't really want to listen to the experts when they said, "Oh, you know, you should start with wide field and then go with longer focal length after." I just wanted to get right in to it, into the meat of it. I wanted to take pictures of galaxies and, you know, but little did I realize that it's so much, I should have listened to them because I was really shocked at, you know, the pictures that I was able to get, like, so much better images with the wider field setup because it's just easier to handle. And then, you know, as you gain knowledge, then you can sort of build your way up to longer focal length. So this was shot through my small 80 millimeter telescope, which is 500 millimeters. And this is another one. This is the Lagoon Nebula. So a lot of targets that I was able to reach. Yep.
No, I just said, wow. I'm just like.
So what would be the equivalent focal length on, rough focal length on that one you were just
saying? So this one's around 500 millimeters.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, I know.
So if I've got a 500 millimeter refracting lens,
you could definitely pick up something like this.
But probably, how long? Do I need a clock timer for?
This one, that's the thing. For astrophotography, for really deep space, and when you're trying to go with longer focal length, you need a tracking mount because, you know, the stars are moving. So this tracking mount here, can you see my mouse, by the way?
Yes, we can.
Okay, so this tracking mount here will basically rotate with the sky as accurately as possible. It's not perfect, so sometimes you will see people with, you know, two telescopes, one main telescope and then a small guide scope. But I'm going to talk about an easier way to overcome this hurdle a little bit later, so just bear with me on that one. I was surprised at being able to get images like this, and because the tracking mounts aren't always really accurate, you have to have a really good mount for that. Taking a wider field sort of photo gives you the illusion of, you know, gives you better looking images because it doesn't need to rely on the extreme accuracy as much. So later on in the year, this was probably in the fall, Canon came out with the 40D, and that was basically a huge thing for astrophotographers that were shooting with the DSLR, because one thing that's really challenging is being able to focus on the stars accurately. And what Canon has with the 40D is this live view feature. So basically, you can hook up your camera to the lens and then view the star on the back of the display. Or you can hook this up to your computer and view view the screen on your laptop and be able to focus the star that way as well. And it just made for just a bit easier time with focusing and getting more accuracy. Also,
So I was going to just say there, just to clarify, some people aren't aware that on if you have a variety of lenses in front of you, they don't all focus sharply when they're cranked out to the infinity or the longest length.
Yeah, that's so true.
So when you're talking about focusing on stars, there may be some people saying, what do you mean? You just put it out to infinity and it's going to be in focus. And the truth is there's many lenses that we use that have a sweet spot of focus that happens before it gets fully extended.
Exactly. And see, I found that out the hard way too. So yeah, when I focus on infinity, it definitely focuses past what it can go. So you need to really pay keen attention to that. Another tip, if you don't have live view, and this worked for me, is looking through the viewfinder. As you focus it, when the star starts to really flicker, that's when you're probably in focus. Because for some reason, when you're not completely in focus, the star just won't have that flickering effect. So find a really, really bright star and try focusing on that.
So okay, just to jump in for one quick sec.
Yeah.
One thing I always do with when people are just starting out, one trick is focusing in the daytime for infinity. And then just switching it all over to manual and just leaving it like that, unless there's a major temperature drop or something like that.
Yeah, that's definitely a good tip as well.
Good for starting out.
Yeah, exactly. And you just have to be very careful not to touch any of your touch your focusing ring. And also another thing is the faster your lens, the more picky it's going to be with focus as well, like especially as the temperature drops through the night. So don't be surprised if as you're taking pictures through the night, your focus changes. So you have to kind of keep on top of it when you're working with fast lenses. So to the next slide here, we see this is basically the Canon 40D's control panel when it's on the computer. So what's really nice is that if you don't have one of those timers, I was able to actually hook this up to my computer and set it up and say, like, I want 5-minute exposures, I want 30 of them, and so on. So it definitely made things a lot easier. And, okay, with that, just want to show you some shots that I took with my with that new Canon 40D. You can see here with this moon picture, it's very sharp, and that was thanks to the live view. And off to the side, this is actually one of my favorite moon shots, because off to the side here you see this is Mars. And I couldn't believe that I was actually able to see a little bit of detail there. You can see some of the dark areas on the surface of Mars. So that just shows you like how well you can focus with that live view. But also that particular day, the seeing conditions were fairly good as well. So here's another shot. Oh, sorry. Actually, this one, I shot this with the 500 millimeter focal length. And this one here, this is Orion Nebula, again, at 500 millimeters. A lot of people don't realize that there's so many things in the night sky are actually really huge. We're thinking, you know, you need a telescope to zoom in to see these small objects, but they're huge, a lot of them. So a camera lens is a nice telephoto lens, or even, you know, a mid-sized lens is pretty good and can get you a lot of targets. Here's Andromeda Galaxy.
Just going to add two questions there in the chat. Cliff asked, is the moon and the Mars shot still with the Celestron microscope?
This one I shot with the 500 millimeters. I know it's even crazier, that's the thing, because that was like even lower focal length. I zoomed in on this picture. I had to crop it. It was a close crop.
Really, really sharp sensor too.
Yes.
And the other thing I was going to say was that when you're talking about when you're showing the nebula shot, when we look up, our eyes don't see it, but the camera sensor is able to pick it up.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yes. And this is a good example of it. This object, Andromeda Galaxy, is around 6 times the diameter of the moon. So can you imagine that? If we had really good vision and we could see this six times the diameter of the moon, it'd be amazing. But a lot of the times when people look up, they'll just see a tiny little smudge, and that tiny little smudge is just this amount of the galaxy. Mm-hmm. So this here was taken with 500 millimeter focal length as well. But I also experimented with my camera lens. So this was done with my 100 to 400 millimeter lens, and I shot this at 200 millimeter focal length. So you can see how big that is. Mm. And just to show you that even though you can shoot the same target over and over again with different lenses, you don't have to toss out the data from other lenses. You can merge them together. So that's what I did here. So by blending the image from the 500 millimeter shot with the 200 millimeter shot, I was able to get this shot, which gave me a much deeper image. And this is all going back to signal to noise ratio and stacking, which I will definitely talk about more.
We are definitely talking about that.
Yeah. So now this was basically my setup in my driveway. And all through the winter, anytime we had clear skies, I would be out there lugging this out onto the driveway. You can see I have my power cables going into the garage. I had my laptop covered in this in the Tupperware. And it just got tedious after a while. I actually lost a laptop to the cold because I didn't protect it well. So I started actually covering the Tupperware with a blanket to keep the heat inside. So when you're out in the cold, definitely take care of your electronics. But what happened was, after a while you get really tired of setting up and tearing down every single night. And no matter how addictive the hobby is, it's just can be a little tedious. So this is when I started to think about adding an observatory to my setup. So this is a SkyShed pod, and basically I bought it it's near Owen Sound. The man who developed this, his name is Wayne Parker, and I don't know if you guys know the band called Glass Tiger.
Oh yeah, we're Canadian, of course we do. Okay. Well, Daryl and I are anyway. Yeah.
So basically, he developed this SkyShed pod, and basically, it's a lot more affordable type of it's an affordable setup for astrophotographers that want to protect their gear. So with that, I set up my little telescope and my two telescopes in here. I had to put them on these brick stilts here because it wasn't tall enough to get above the edge or the wall. The SkyShed pod has these bays, and in one of the bays I was able to put a computer. And you'll see later in some of the in another setup shot, you'll see the computer. And it basically just made things so much easier. So it was very well sealed from the weather and protected. So each night when I wanted to take pictures, I just had to open up the dome and start. And
Kerry,
yes,
is that dome motorized?
No, it's not. So I have
to. So you have to turn it by hand. Oh no, that's awesome.
But you know what? I thought it would be really challenging to do, but when I was 9 months pregnant, I was still able to move this.
You know what? What you say about getting tired of setting it up, I have a very small setup. I use a 480 millimeter f/6.
Yeah.
And I get incredibly tired of setting it up and then having to align it to the earth so you get that rotation.
Yes.
I get very annoyed. So that's my next thing right there.
Yes, the SkyShed pod. Check it out.
Worth the price of admission right there.
And actually, my husband and I were just talking about it today, about how well it's held up. It's been just coming up to 6 years now, and wow. It's in great condition. I mean, in the sunshine, when I have a like a table, I guess, at the back to push the dome completely off so I have clear view of the zenith. And it does get a little warped in the sun if I leave it out over for a couple of days. So it's a bit of a challenge putting it back on. But other than that, it's great. I mean, I do have problems with them. If you're a little squeamish about bugs and snakes and things like that, then be aware of this. Because every season, every year, I have like a different outbreak in this pod. One year I had snakes and we're just basically constantly getting rid of the snakes, like throwing them out into the, like taking them as far as we could out into the forest. They love the computer.
You have a little portable heater out there too for the winter months.
Yeah. Actually, that's not the heater. That's the fan to keep things somewhat cool in the summer.
Cool in summer.
Yeah, so I have that fan set up on automatic mode so that when it hits 30 degrees Celsius, it will turn on. So actually where that fan is right now is where I have the computer, and then the laptop is sitting on the table. The monitor is sitting on the table above it.
Okay. Well, just before you move on, I'm going to start to share some links that you might want to cut and paste, because there's a few of them as you talk to that you've shared, and also a link that Daryl's going to share to some great information about night photography, so that they could have it after the show to go and investigate.
Yeah, great. Also, did you get some of my links from earlier?
I did.
Today?
Yes.
Okay.
And I'm going to share those in the comments here, so people can save those. And
good. So I don't have to unscreen share then?
No, I'm going to share them in the comments here.
I just put mine in the group chat in here.
Great.
Thanks. You can throw it up if you want.
Okay. Carry on.
All right. Anyways, just wanted to share this light pollution map with you guys. So up here, the white is really high light pollution. This is Toronto, the greater Toronto area. This light pollution area is from Hamilton, and this area here is from Buffalo. This is St. Catharines. So I'm kind of in the middle of all of this light pollution. So just to let you know that, it's not, I don't have the best conditions, and you don't have to have the best conditions in order to do astrophotography. One thing, though, that has helped me is a light pollution filter. This is a clip filter, and you can actually, you clip this on in front of the sensor, and the only problem is this only works on crop cameras. It doesn't work on full-frame cameras, I guess because the mirror gets in the way. So that's the only side effects. But it worked with my Canon 40D. And the thing is, it makes a huge difference. I don't know if any of you guys know, but with the DSLR cameras, they also put an IR blocking filter on the chip. And what happens is that actually cuts out some of the hydrogen alpha or the red parts of nebulas. Which can be a bit of a problem, but with this light pollution filter, I've had such good luck with being able to still pick up reds, or at least, I guess it helps to kind of narrow things out a little bit, cuts out the light pollution, the air glow enough for this really faint emission line to actually make it through. So here's an example. With the clip filter, I was able to take the picture of the Veil Nebula. It's kind of hard to see here, but you can see the Veil Nebula here. This was taken from home when it's not even 40, it's just 45 degrees up above the horizon. And then this picture here is without the light pollution filter at a dark sky location straight ahead. So, the higher up you are, like the straight, when you're imaging straight up, you get less problems with light pollution from surrounding towns and things like that. You get the best conditions for photographing. So imaging lower down in the sky is definitely not ideal. So the fact that I was able to see this nebula with the light pollution filter from home in light polluted skies, low down, and comparing this to a dark sky location, I was pretty amazed. So the thing is, a lot of people will tell you, when you have your DSLR, you should modify it. And modifying your camera to remove the IR filter is definitely a good thing to do. But if you are a serious daytime photographer, I find you may run into some challenges with white balance. I mean, you could do custom white balances, and of course you can do some adjustments in Lightroom to fix that, but I just noticed that there's just certain colors just don't render as well once you take that IR filter off of the sensor. The thing is, I don't know what the technology is now. Maybe things are better, but for me at the time, I chose not to modify my camera, and basically decided to substitute it with using a light pollution filter. So here's a picture of the Veil Nebula from a dark sky location without the filter. And here it is from home in light polluted skies. So you can definitely see there's a lot more red that's been picked up. The red that basically is normally lost and hard to see, I can finally pick it up.
Wow.
Yeah, and so I was kind of on a mission after this point just to kind of prove to people that you don't need to modify your camera. Of course, like I said, it's better, but, you know, me being on a mission, like, no one was going to stop me. I had to prove to them that you don't have to do it. And this picture here was kind of a testament to that because this was just a target, like a number of targets that's just filled with a lot of red, you know, hydrogen alpha, and you know, that emission line that's not supposed to be very easily picked up with an unmodified camera. And so this actually was shot with the 500 millimeter lens again, and it was 3 hours exposure, stacked exposure now, so probably took a whole number of 5 minute exposures, and I stacked them and processed them. And this image here, I took this with the 100 millimeter lens, my favorite macro lens. So who'd ever thought that at 100 millimeters focal length, you can see all this color in the sky?
Wow.
I know.
That is unbelievable. That's something.
Yeah. So I continued on my quest. This was the 100 to 400 millimeter lens. I took this at, this was at 400 millimeters. This is the Virgo galaxy cluster. So you can see there's actually thousands of galaxies in this cluster. And I mean, you have to zoom in to really see a lot of it. But I was just really excited to be able to get such a nice wide field of this area of the sky. And this is the double cluster in Cassiopeia, constellation Cassiopeia, the W in the sky. I don't know if you guys recognize it in the northern sky. And then here is Comet Hartley, so 400 millimeters focal length. So now onto my setup. So here you can see my computer's now in the pod. And I did go through a number of changes with my setup. I got a new mount, a little beefier, that can hold a bit more weight. And I got a new telescope. This one is a Ritchie Chrétien 8-inch. It's an Astrotech brand. And basically, the optics in this telescope is similar to the Hubble's. It's two mirrors. They're hyperbolic mirrors. And with this, it's actually not that heavy, not too heavy. It's got a carbon fiber tube, so it makes it less sensitive to temperature changes. And it basically kind of stepped it up for me a notch with my photography. Here's the side view of the telescope. I also ended up using a CCD, buying a CCD camera, a cooled CCD camera, because as you know, DSLRs can produce a lot of noise, especially when you increase the temperature. So if you take shots when it's really cold out, you'll notice a lot less noise than if you take pictures when it's, you know, 20 Celsius or, you know, in the summertime, basically. Yeah, so with this cooled CCD, it cools to, oh dear, I can't even remember now, 40 degrees below the ambient. I think it's this one, or this is the other one that is 40 degrees below. It cools it really good. And because of that, you get a lot less noise. So, and oh yeah, and also I ended up changing my mount because I had problems with the other one. So it's just kind of never ending, the spending. So here is a shot with the cooled CCD camera, and it really makes a difference with the quality of the image because of the low noise.
Yeah.
And with that Ritchie Cretchan telescope, I found the star colors were so much more, like really popped out a lot more. This star here.
Stuart in the comments just mentioned for anyone watching that he's been surfing the Astronomics filter site, and they now do have clip filters for full-frame Canons.
Oh, that's great. So thanks, Stuart. Stuart is a good friend of mine.
Stuart's awesome.
Yeah, he's a friend of mine, too, but through
Cool.
Yeah.
Small world. Okay, that's so good. Happy to know that. So this is what I was going to say. This star here is Gamma Cassiopeia. So if you look at the constellation Cassiopeia, it's the middle star in there. And then it's just pretty neat to see all this nebulosity that's actually around there. This picture here is Hercules globular cluster, M13. It's very famous. That picture's rocking. Oh, thanks. Yeah, and it's really nice with that telescope too, because the star color just really comes out beautifully. And then this picture here is the Orion Nebula, and with that that telescope, it is I forgot to mention that it is around. I'm running it at around 1,000. Millimeters in focal length. So at 1,000 millimeters, the Orion Nebula, you get this much of it. That's gorgeous. It's really close-up shot.
We take pictures of our moon. We go out and we grab our 200 millimeter lens, and you know, on a crop sensor, and we're taking these pictures just for fun on our tripods. And to think that this is only 1,000 millimeters. I mean, we're not looking at that much bigger of a distance. It's incredible.
I know. And that's the thing, like, in astrophotography, it's like a whole new world. And, you know, we spend a lot of time just photographing things that we can see, but there's so much, like thousands and thousands of objects in the night sky to take pictures of. And a lot of times, it's funny, people are taking pictures of this and they don't even realize.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, here is one of my favorites. I love dusty nebulas because I never really thought that we could actually, you know, things are kind of dark in space anyways and they're very dim, but I never thought I'd actually be able to pick up dust in space, and that's what this is. And you can see this blue star here is illuminating the dust around it, so you see like blue. This is called a reflection nebula here because it's reflecting the light is. The dust is reflecting off of the blue star.
I have another thing in from the comments. Owen was asking, was the movie Contact with Jodie Foster an influence on you?
No, but that is my favorite movie.
Oh, okay.
I was doing this way before the movie. But yeah, I love that movie. I watch it over and over again.
Yeah, and he was saying that when he was at the David Dunlap Observatory, which is where we met, was in the boondocks in a wonderful high school trip.
Oh, yeah. So this picture here, I mean, it's not the greatest shot, but it's cool. It has a story behind it. And this is Comet McNaught, a rare time where it passed in front of this galaxy, NGC 25281. I think it's 281. Anyways, this picture I took while I was in bed, because what happens is I have my computer controlling the telescope in the pod, and I have a VNC or remote desktop sort of application that I ran on my iPod, so I was able to connect to the computer that controlled the telescope while I was under the covers in bed at 3 a.m. in the morning. So I collected the frames for this target at that time. And then here, so part of the fun, another aspect of fun with astrophotography is collaborating with other people. So this is one of my favorite collaborations I did with Stefano Cancelli. He actually lives right by the airport, Toronto Airport. He's got a lot of light pollution as well. So actually a lot more light pollution than me. But we teamed up to basically combine our data to then produce this image here. This is the Conan the Foxfur Nebula. If you or the Christmas tree cluster, if you rotate this image to the left 90 degrees, it looks like a Christmas tree. Here is the cone, and some people say this looks like Mary and baby Jesus. And then here is the fox, and you can see the head of the fox.
Yeah, the fox is there.
Yeah, with the fur. Oh. Speaking
of
fox.
Timing.
Yep. And then here's another collaboration. This collaboration was also done in the Golden Horseshoe area of Southern Ontario, so in light-polluted sort of areas, with Stefano Cancelli again. We combined our data to produce this of this picture of M31 Andromeda Galaxy. And then here's another collaboration that I did with a friend, Paul Mortfield. He has an amazing setup in the dark skies of the Sierra Mountains, and he connects to it remotely from Toronto, and basically he collected the frames and then he handed them over to me to do the processing for it. So, and he tends to give me a lot of the dark and dusty nebulae because he knows I love them.
So let me just backtrack for a second. You said he collects images remotely. And then he sends them to you.
Yeah, so he controls the telescope through using like a VNC or remote desktop type program, and then he can get or FTP the images or to his home in the Toronto area.
That's impressive. That's really something.
Yeah, and then he sent them to me on a disk to work on. And so now let's switch gears a little bit. We're going to talk a bit about stacking. So when you start taking pictures of the night sky, a single frame from your camera, it doesn't look very impressive. So this is a picture of the galaxy M51. And you just don't see much detail. And if you have light polluted skies, you'll get this brown looking sky. So when we start to bring out the details or trying to stretch the image to get more color and details, this is what we get with one single frame. So it's not very nice because there's so much noise. But as you start to stack the images, you get better results. And the whole thing is that noise is random. So when you start to average or median combine these frames, you get a cleaner image. A lot of people will wonder, actually I even wondered this too when I first started out, is why can't I just stack the same image over and over again? Why do I have to take so many different images? And that's because the noise is random. So you definitely need to take a number of frames. So the more frames you stack, the better. And this is a result of 38 frames stacked and fully processed in Photoshop. And I guess the law behind it is the inverse square law. So if you take four stacked images, you get half the amount of noise, and then so forth, as you can see.
Are you keeping your camera at, or I don't know if this is the normal camera or that cool?
This is not the cool camera, sorry. This is still okay. my DSLR.
So you have it at the lowest ISO setting then?
Yeah, this one I set it at actually 800 okay. ISO. That's actually what I use a lot for my astrophotography with the DSLR is 800. Because if you go too high with that, you start to lose good quality color, and I mean, obviously you'll increase the noise too, but 800, I mean, some people use 400 ISO as well, and that can help you with the star color a little bit more. So yeah, so stacking the images you can see just makes a huge difference in the quality of the image. And I actually started applying this to just tripod shots. And here's one image. One night, I basically wanted to hang out with my astronomy club friends, and I stopped taking my telescope with me. Ever since I got the setup in the dome, I didn't want to move it. And you'll see why. I'm going to show you another picture why I don't want to touch it. But I just wanted to go out and be relaxed and take pictures with my camera and tripod. So that's basically it. But the thing is, when you're in a light polluted area, this shot I took near Hamilton. It's south of Hamilton, but still close enough where it's not perfectly dark sized. And I figured, you know what, I'm going to try stacking the images to see if that actually helps with the signal to noise ratio and also will allow me to bring out the Milky Way a lot more than what it showed up in a single frame. You see a lot of people, when they go to dark skies, they take a single frame shot and it looks beautiful, like single 20-second, 30-second shot, and you'd be amazed. But here I take the 20-second shot and it doesn't look very great, but I decided to stack them. So basically, the top half, I stacked a number of frames, and then I also took a frame for the lower half. And in Photoshop, I blended the top and the bottom frame.
Okay, that was what I was going to ask, because I figured in the time that it takes to stack the photos, the stars will have moved.
Yeah, and you can see here, I didn't do too good of a job with blending it, because you can see when you're stacking on the stars, the landscape is going to get blurry. So, yep.
If I can just ask you a quick question. I do majority of my stuff in pretty dark skies, so single images are pretty good for me. But with this, how do you get away from field rotation? Are you on a regular tripod? Or?
I'm on a regular tripod, and the thing is, when it stacks the image, the landscape will appear to will be blurry. It will.
Oh, so you're stacking in Deep Sky Stacker?
Yeah, I stack in deep.
Okay, gotcha.
So something's gonna give. The stars are gonna be sharp, but the landscape's gonna be blurry because it's Deep Sky Stacker is stacking on the stars, which are moving. So now basically that day, being a meteorologist, I saw that I knew we were under high pressure and the winds were gonna be really calm. And I saw that there was a bit of a reflection, and I was pretty excited thinking that, you know what, tomorrow I'm going to show up again and I'm going to take the same shot and hopefully there will be absolutely no ripple in the water. And sure enough, that's what happened. So this is after just that one day made a huge difference in the overall, in the reflection quality. So again, same method, but I did a little bit better job at blending the landscape in with the sky. So now just on to the next thing. I want to show you. This is what basically the bottom underneath my telescope looks like in the pod, and this will explain to you why I don't like to travel with my setup. It's such a mess of wires. And to actually be able to carry this around with me and set up and tear down would just be incredibly overwhelming. And I think it's these kind of things that stop, you know, regular daytime photographers from getting too deep into astrophotography, like deep sky astrophotography. But I'm going to show you here. I'm going to get out of screen share and I'm going to show you this little tracking unit that I bought that just made things so much easier. So let's see, how do I do this?
Just like that. You're out.
Okay. Am I showing up now?
Yes, you're perfectly fine.
Okay, good. So basically I bought this unit. Can you see it?
Yeah.
So this is a sky tracker, Ioptron sky tracker. And the thing is, I always wanted like if I go on vacation, if I ever go to the southern hemisphere, or even have a chance to go up north to get to some dark skies, I want to still be able to do deep sky astrophotography. So this little unit makes it so much easier for me. It sounds like a big plug for Ioptron. Sorry. Just trying to make things easier for everyone, really. There are a lot of different tracking mounts out there that are compact and easy to travel with. So the thing is, you don't need a fancy big tracking mount to do deep sky astrophotography.
So for those of us who are uninitiated, what exactly does it do for you? Like, what's the function of a sky tracker?
The thing is, this is going to track with the stars. So you can take much longer exposures and absorb a lot more light with something like this. The thing is, when you're taking a picture, a wide field picture, let's say a 17 millimeter shot, you might not necessarily need something like this. You could do the stacking method that I did, like stack 20 second exposures and probably do okay. But if you want to start zooming in on targets like at 100 millimeters or, 300, 400 millimeters, you'll realize that you can't take, on a tripod, you cannot take that long of an exposure without there being some kind of trailing in the stars. And actually, it boils down to the 600 rule. I don't know if any of you have heard of it. Actually, I think Daryl had this.
So I was just going to say that the nice thing about those two, just to add to it, I still use my big one. This, how much does that weigh?
Oh dear, I don't know, but it's very light.
Just to give you a quick example, I have a very
It's 7.7 pounds.
There you go. I have what's known as a German equatorial mount that I still use for certain types of photography. It weighs 40 pounds.
Yeah.
I don't lug it too many places. So just for a quick example, to have a little unit like that, and there's other ones out there, but to have a little unit like that is awesome if you're going to do something like a composite image of a meteor shower or something like that, because you can set it up, you can go sit down and fall asleep with your hot chocolate in your lawn chair. you don't have to constantly move that tripod.
Yeah, that's a great application, actually. I never even thought about that, meteor showers. I usually don't do a lot of meteor shooting, but yeah, if you point it up at the sky, it's tracking for the sky, and you're bound to get a lot of meteors or some meteors going through the frame because, a lot of times you can't predict when they're going to go through. But anyway, so with this tracking unit, it just makes things a lot easier. It's lighter. It's this size of this unit here is book-sized, and it fits in this little pouch. Sorry, did someone... Oh, that was something in the background. But on here, can you see my lens here as well?
Yes.
Yeah, so I've got the 100 to 400 millimeters on here. The payload for this, though, is 7.7 pounds, and this setup here with my Canon 6D and the 100 to 400 is exactly 6.6 pounds. So I got lucky there. So the reason why people would want the heavier mounts, though, is because it will support a higher payload, like if you want to start working with prime lenses or refractors, apochromatic refractors, or even, different types of telescopes, you're going to want a heavier mount for this. The other thing, too, is the longer focal length that you go, the more accuracy you're going to need. So you're going to need a heavier mount. But this unit here is good for if you just want to do wide field or semi-wide field. So let's say 100 to 400 millimeters. This is perfect for that kind of setup. So you'll get pretty good accuracy. Now with this mount here, at 400 millimeters, I was able to get 60-second exposures. It's not the best in accuracy compared to some other mounts, but for me, this fit my budget, and I figure I could work with 60-second exposures and stack that. This is just my regular tripod, my Manfrotto tripod, and the Manfrotto ball head. that's on here. So all I needed to buy was just this little unit here, and it came with the base. So that's it. So this is definitely a great solution for people that want to get into deep sky astrophotography without all the fuss of the wires and everything. And it's fairly affordable compared to what else is out there.
Yeah.
And easy to travel with. I could put that in my suitcase or, you know.
Yeah.
Yes. Sorry, you cut out there.
Uh-oh, I think we lost Ron. Okay. Well, while we're waiting for Ron, is there any chance you can quickly explain what that little tube was sticking out for
people? Oh, yeah. Sorry.
It's here. Okay. No.
This right here, can you see that?
Mm-hmm.
That's the polar finder. So the thing is, it's one thing that's a real pain about tracking mounts is that you have to align it on the North Star, or in the Southern Hemisphere, you've got to align on the stars there. But this makes it so much easier to do that. You just have to locate the North Star and, you know, get it roughly within sight in the tube. And then there is an app for your phone, Apple, an iPhone, or even, you know, Android phone, that basically tells you exactly what location within this tube the North Star should be at that given time. So it's very quick. Okay.
Ron's back.
There we go.
I'm back. Someone said
yeah. I can't do a screen share for some reason.
Did the stream continue, Ron?
No, I don't think anybody can see us.
Ah.
Oh. That wouldn't be good.
No. It says we'll be right back.
Well, I need to go because my children are...
Okay.
Not behaving tonight, unfortunately. So, but it was wonderful to meet you, and I.
Me too, Erica.
I friended you on, I circled you, so I'll be in contact later.
Okay, that's Take great. Care. Yeah, and Pleasure. I have more information on my blog too, so well, maybe that I'll might help out a little bit.
I'll definitely check it out, and then I'm going to start researching this. This sounds like a lot of fun.
So. Yeah,
it is. It's addictive.
Yep, I've got a lot of friends who are in. I think it'll be good. I think I can find some people to do this with.
Yes, excellent. I'd love to see the results.
All right, take care. Bye-bye.
Okay, bye.
So, Ron?
It appears to still be running, Ron.
Okay.
Can other people see us?
I can see the stream. I can see the stream in the other in my other window.
Okay.
Open up YouTube here.
I think. Yeah, and Stuart says that he can see us. So.
Yeah, we're good.
Okay. I think
I'm downloading Deep Sky Stacker.
Okay.
If you can't screen share, I will.
So hopefully okay, sorry about that, guys.
Is it possible that I can leave here and come back in? Maybe the window crashed.
Yeah, sure. You can join the same invite.
Okay, let's give this a shot.
Sure.
It started to rebroadcast on YouTube, so I'm hoping it fixes itself without us having to restart a thing.
Be good.
Yeah, good. They're saying that we're on. So.
Okay, it's working again, guys.
Oh, good.
Yay. Phew, thank goodness. I was just trying to think, like, how on earth am I going to do the rest of the show if I can't speak?
Just describe it all to us. Right?
Okay, so let me get Deep Sky Stacker open here.
Could do it in charades, right?
Now this is the short.
All right, here it is. Phew. Okay.
There we go.
That?
Yes.
Okay, Deep Sky Stacker.
Relief.
Yes. So it's definitely a nice and easy program to run. The thing is, I actually set up a file list already. All you have to do, I'm just going to open up the file list first. So,
hey, Kerry, just mention that it's a free program too.
Yes, it's a free program, which is why I'm showing this to you guys. Because I just didn't want, you know, if you're starting into astrophotography, I figure it's not, you know, you don't want to spend too much money right off the bat. So,
is there a Mac version for that program?
I don't know, actually.
Hold on, I believe there is. Hold on a second here. Give me a second, I'll let you know when I find out.
Okay, just post it in the stream, and that'd be great.
So the thing is, with this program, it's kind of flickering right now. I'm not sure why. There's a bunch of bugs going on here in my system. But basically, with Deep Sky Stacker, it makes it pretty easy. All you have to load are the picture files, the light frames. Light frames are basically the frames that you used to take the image, the image files. So if you're shooting, in this case, I was shooting Orion Nebula with my Ioptron. Basically, I took a bunch of 60-second exposure. I took about 57 of them, and you load them all in here. So they're called light frames. Then the dark frames, you need to have the dark frames because that helps with handling the noise. So not only does the stacking of the multiple frames helps, but stacking of dark frames helps. And dark frames are basically images of the black of the darkness, I guess. So basically, if you cover up your camera lens and cover up your camera to make sure there's no light, you're going to want to take as many images as you can at the same temperature that you took those light frames at and with the same exposure settings, the same same time and the same ISO.
Interesting.
So they're dark frames. Actually, I usually take around 15 of them, 15 to 20 dark frames. Then there's the flat frames. Flat frames are basically frames that is basically showing you the illumination through your camera lens. So if you have vignetting, it's gonna show the vignetting of your camera lens. If you have dust, it's gonna take care of that as well. And I wanted to click on it so you guys can see, but I'm not sure if anything pops up. Okay, you see that there? So that is a flat frame. So you can see the, and basically what I do is I set it, the camera, at ISO 100 and aperture priority to take my light frames, and I shoot up at the sky just after sunset, or I've even had good luck with shooting at a white screen on my monitor. The thing is, you want to have a uniform light that you're shooting at to be able to capture the vignetting. And you will see why it's important to not have vignetting in your deep sky pictures, because as you start to stretch it and bring out the details, the vignetting will become more and more of a problem. Also, as you start stretching the image, you'll see more camera dust that's on the lens. So this, the flat frames takes care of that. So basically, when you load all these files in here, you'll want to register the images. So you click on Register Checked Images, and then Deep Sky Stacker will go through and analyze all your light frames, your picture frames, and match the stars up. It will give you an angle and a displacement in X and Y, and also a score. And the score will kind of give you an indication of how good your frame quality is. So you can see here some values. So the really low scoring ones, most of the times is because maybe a cloud went over at the time, or my tracking was really bad. And then the high scores, you can tell, are probably very good quality image. You can just click on them anyways just to verify for yourself if the image is good. So here's an here's a single frame of the Orion Nebula shot through with the help of the Ioptron Sky Tracker in my 400 millimeter lens, my 100 to 400 at 400 millimeters. Mm-hmm. And so you can actually see the vignetting here too of the lens.
Yeah, just before you move on, there was a question, and I kind of had the question too, and I think you sort of answered it, but I didn't catch it. And that the question was, if you have no light coming in, then why do you need, like you said, you shoot like 15 black frames or dark frames.
Yeah.
Why do you need so many frames? Why not just one frame?
Because again, you want to take as many frames as possible to average out that random noise that your camera has on the sensor. Yeah. So you're basically helping it out even further. The light frames, by stacking your light frames, you're averaging out your noise. And by taking your dark frames, you're also doing that same thing as well. And these programs have a very smart way of subtracting the dark frame noise and also, you know, averaging out the noise with your light frames as well. And it's also going to take care of the vignetting and the dust motes on the sensor with the help of the flat frames. So once this is all registered, then you can go ahead and stack the images. And with the images, here you can see it gives you a total, it says 57 minutes, because I have 57 1-minute exposures. And it goes through and it kind of gives you some recommended, if you click on recommended settings, it'll tell you what it recommends you to do based on the number of frames that you have. So it's actually pretty easy. And there's so much information about this on the Deep Sky Stacker website. You can actually sign up for their Yahoo list and really get a lot of information and help from people there. The group is excellent. So now, after I click stack the frames, I'm not going to do it on the show because it will take forever and use up a lot of my system resources. But anyway, so once you start stacking and you get a final image, it will pop up in the display here. And it's going to look very disappointing because it's going to look very dark. And you're going to be tempted to actually use some of the processing tools that Deep Sky Stacker has in here, but I totally recommend to not do it. What you should do is you will get a 32-bit TIFF file. I recommend just saving it to 16 bits and then putting it into opening it up into Photoshop. So I'm just going to close this window here. And okay, I'm back. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to open up Photoshop. Is everyone with me?
Yes.
Okay, good.
Yes.
So I'm going to do another screen share. I hope this works. Oh, goodness, it doesn't work. I'm going to close this again. Okay, guys, sorry.
It's okay. This has plagued Hangouts since the beginning of Hangouts.
Yeah.
Yeah, part of the way things go.
Okay, I'm gonna rejoin you guys again.
Okay,
you're right.
And now while she's gone, we'll talk behind her back.
Absolutely.
Yeah, this is fantastic. I love this stuff. Now I know Daryl, you're very familiar with a lot of this.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah. But that was really fast. We didn't get a chance to talk about you behind your back.
I know this is probably taking a long time now. This show's probably over time, right?
Yeah, we're over time. If you want to just find a way to summarize the final assembly, I don't know if you can do that.
Okay, I'm going to do that right now.
Go ahead. I'll just let you go ahead and see what you can do with that.
Did you get the screen share? Oh, it didn't work.
You were sharing Ron there for a second. Uh-oh.
It did work, but it popped off, so she's coming back again.
Okay. That's
good. It would be nice just to see the final steps in Photoshop.
There she is.
You're back. You did have me share for a second there.
Yes. Start screen share.
There you go.
Do you see this?
Yep.
Okay, thank goodness. Okay, now we can get going. So so this is basically what the image is going to look like, coming straight out of Deep Sky Stacker, saved as 16 bits. And it really doesn't look that impressive because, you know, especially in the single raw file, it looks, you know, you could see a lot more information. But believe me, the 16-bit TIFF file has a lot of information. So what I'd like to do is apply curve stretches, and I know some people have been asking about this, like, what are curve stretches? So what it is I go into the adjustment panel here, and I'm going to open up a curves window. And basically what I'm going to do is just kind of brighten up this whole area here. And I'm going to do a sequence of brightening up and until you can start to see the nebula. I'm going to duplicate this, Control-J, and you can start to see more of the nebula. I'm going to take a look at the histogram. So you're going to start seeing some combing because as I'm doing the curve stretches, it's kind of working in this 8-bit mode, so it looks pretty weird. I'm going to just apply. Now as it's, actually I'm going to do another Control-J, repeat that, so it's a lot brighter. And then I'm going to do another curve stretch. But this one, sorry, is not a stretch. I'm going to actually make it a little bit darker, make the background darker. So what I'm going to do is drag, instead of bringing up the midpoint of the curve, I'm going to drag the bottom left part of the curve down to darken the background just a little bit. So it doesn't look like much yet, but now I'm going to do Shift, Control, Alt, and E, and it's going to consolidate all those layers. So do you see that?
Yes.
So much better image. So now you can see more nebulosity. And what we're going to do is we're not going to stop there. We're going to keep on going. We're going to do just another curve stretch here. And so if we didn't apply the flat frames, at this point we'll start to see vignetting. It'll start to get dark around the edges. And the more I apply these curve stretches, it's going to get worse and worse, and then there's going to be a point where we can't go any further with this image. So definitely you need the flat frames. But now what I'm starting to see here is a light pollution gradient. So you can see it's darker up here and then it gets lighter down there. Do you guys see that?
Mm-hmm.
Yep. Yeah. So actually I'm going to pull down this curve, this part here, just a little bit. What we're doing is we're stretching the histogram out because there's such a high dynamic range in this image. And looking at the histogram here, you can see it's very thin, like all the pixels are kind of within a certain range right now, but we really want this to spread out more. So I'm going to Shift, Control, Alt, and E again. And what I'm going to do now is I'm going to apply a gradient, A, a, of gradient exterminator, I guess, plugin, you can call it. So you can do this manually through Photoshop with blurring and other techniques with using your layer blending modes. But seriously, it's really worth it to get this plugin here called Gradient Exterminator. I think
I'm just putting that in the comments right now.
Yeah, and this, I think it runs about $50 for this plugin. But anyway, so when you run it, it's going to actually give you some options. And for a big gradient like what I have, it's very coarse gradient. I want it to be low aggressiveness. So, and usually I don't click on balancing background color. So I'm just going to click OK. And it's going to run. And then it's hard to see, but the gradient probably got better. You can see it here when I toggle it. See that? And if it looks like it overcorrected, you can always back off on the opacity. So what I'm going to do now is, it doesn't look very good in the background. You can see it's kind of murky, brown, light polluted color. So what I like to do is I open up another curves layer, and I will set my blend mode to color. And what I'm going to do is I want to adjust the color without adjusting like how dark or bright it is. So I'm going to click on the black eyedropper. And I usually set this for like, you know, 11 by 11. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to take that black eyedropper and I'm going to click on the background. So what happens is it's going to neutralize it. So you can see here before, if you look at the histogram, all the colors were not aligned. But then when I use the black eyedropper, it aligns it nicely. And now to get like the bright colors, to get things to line up nicely with that, I'm going to take the white eyedropper. And usually if you don't have, usually what I do with my other, you know, with astrophotos where I have a lot of star color that recognizable star color, I will click on a white toned star. But in this case, it's kind of tough. Like with DSLR images, it's a little bit tougher with when it comes to the color, especially with this type of lens. So I'm just going to kind of click on the whitest part, the brightest part of the image. So it just adjusts it ever so slightly, just to make sure that the color is somewhat balanced. So now I can continue curve stretching. I'm going to darken it up a little bit more to get more of a background, darker background. And I'm going to apply some more stretches, midpoint stretches here. And just keep repeating the process over and over again. And I repeat this until I start to see some noise. When I start to see noise, I know it's time to kind of back off. So if I go to the navigator and zoom in, it's not too bad right now. I can still go further. And I think a lot of people, you know, they will stop kind of at this point, or they won't even get this far because they just, you know, they just don't know how far to go, especially, you know, if they're not using this kind of a technique. I mean, there are lots of different ways to do it, but I just find this way will get you a lot of depth. So I'm going to keep stretching this out a little bit more. And, you know, basically I can spend hours doing stuff like this, just tweaking. So you see the difference now, right?
Oh, yeah.
So huge difference. I'm just going to do, like, consolidate all these layers into a group. So new group from layers. I'll just call it group one. And I'm going to toggle it on and off. So this is what we work with, what we started with, and this is what we have right now.
Wow.
So I'm going to add one more. And the thing is, a lot of people will ask, okay, why don't you make your sky black? The thing is, if you make it black, you're going to start clipping a lot of the details. There's so much stuff in the night sky that's just barely above the background, like dust and things like that. And if you make your background black, you won't even see it. So I usually, for nebulae, I like to leave it around, you know, I'm going to actually join all this layer together here. so you can see the histogram better. So along the histogram, if I put my mouse over it, just as it starts to get dark, or sorry, just as it starts to do a steep slope, I try to make sure that that number is around like 25 or so. So I made this just a little bit darker than what I would normally go. But around for nebulae, I like to make it around 25, so a little bit brighter. But then galaxies, I make it a little bit darker. So I don't mind going with 10s and 15s for galaxies. So we can just do maybe one more curve stretch, and then we're okay. So now the thing is, you're left with a core that's really bright, and this is one of those objects where a lot of people, they like to, they want to see the detail in the core, but with that being lost, you need to bring that back. And what I do is I will take one of these layers that I consolidated down below before I did massive stretching, and I like to bring it up to the top and kind of blend it in. So I'll do like a control J to duplicate that layer. And actually, I forgot. I need to consolidate this layer here. Sorry, I'm just gonna merge. Okay, no, I'll do it this way. Sorry, guys. Shift Control Alt N E. And then I will drag this layer here for just underneath it. I'll toggle it on, and then what I like to do is I will select color range is one way that you can do it, and you can just choose a brighter part to start with your mask and then blend it in as a layer mask. But another way you can do it too is you create a layer mask, so we'll go layer mask reveal all, and actually what we'll do is we'll take the black, is it, am I right here? Take the black paintbrush and we'll paint in here in the middle, and you can start to see that the nebulosity from below, this one here, is starting to show through, but it looks kind of ugly. So what I usually will do is kind of blend it out with the feather tool. You can feather out your layer mask.
That's such a great word, nebulosity.
So, and I kind of feather it out so it doesn't give you that ugly gray look, but just enough, just so you can make out the core a little bit better. So that's kind of the difference that you'll see there.
I keep hearing Uncle Remus singing, "She's Got Nebulosity," sorry.
Yeah. So this is after, this is before, and this is after. So a little bit better there. Mm-hmm. So there's so much more that you can do with this. I'm not sure if we have enough time. But one thing that I discovered, actually hold on a second.
Yeah, don't worry so much about the time. We still have fairly good audience retention. There's a couple of people in there still hungry, okay. So we'll just do one more thing. I just wanted to make a note, though. Gary makes a really good point in the comments, and Gary says, let's just dump all of your knowledge out of your head into a memory stick, mm-hmm. and then we can all just take it with us.
Yeah. It's unbelievable. Really, there's so much to learn in this, and you could spend years just trying to figure it all out. But you know what? It's so worth it in the end. You know, just the little bit of knowledge that you gain as you go along. It's a lot of fun. But, so what I want to show you is I will also use Camera Raw Filter in here to do some noise reduction. I never used to use Camera Raw Filter, but I found it just works so beautifully. And with that, I won't demonstrate this, but what I will do is I will go to Camera Raw, do the noise reduction, and then what I will do is select the background, and because the most of your noise that you're going to get is going to be in the black background.
Sure. So
get your noise reduced in the background, so that way you retain your detail in the brighter parts. Another thing that I found pretty surprising, and I had no idea about Nick software until I until I joined Google Plus. Yeah, with Nick's software, there's this tool called Color Effects Pro.
Yeah.
So just give it a little time to load. So my machine's a little bit slow. I think it's just overworked with all of this. The new computer, too.
I have two questions while that loads. Troy would like to know, what do you use over the lens to take your flat frames?
I will either shoot at the sky, even on a cloudy day, like if I see that there's uniform clouds, like there's not a lot of texture in the clouds, I'll just shoot up the clouds. I'll even shoot into my notepad on my computer screen, so just a big white screen. I'll make sure the lens is really close. Okay, so there's a number of different ways. So here's Detail Extractor on the Nick color effects. And I couldn't believe that this thing actually brings out a lot of really faint, dusty nebulosity around there. And I'm thinking, for a 1 hour shot, 60 second shots in light polluted skies, I couldn't believe it. So I usually just accept the defaults. You can play with the settings here. It's going to look a little bit ugly because I didn't run noise reduction on this first. Usually you should run noise reduction first before you start getting into this, because you're just going to end up with more issues. But I'm not sure if you notice it here. There's more dust layers in here.
Yeah.
So if I do a toggling on and off, you get that. And then you can also lower the opacity of that a little bit to get it to your liking. And also another thing that the Detail Extractor does is it kind of takes care of the core a little bit as well too. So the core comes back, a little bit more detail in the core comes back. There's a whole lot of things that you can do here in Photoshop. Also with star trailing, like because my tracking wasn't perfect, you get a little bit of elongated stars. One cool trick is if I do Shift Control Alt and E to consolidate the layers again, I can click on darken, choose the layer mode to darken, and then I'm going to grab this move tool, and I'm going to click on the image, and I'm going to use the arrow key and just shift it by a little bit. And all of a sudden, your star trails get a lot better. See the difference?
Wow. We should have you back. We're going to have you back at some point just to do the Photoshop stuff and all the little, just spend a whole hour on that.
Yeah, because there's so much to do. Like even, with the sharpening with the high-pass filters and things like that. But really, after I'll play around with this in Photoshop for a while, sometimes I take a couple of days because you can just sit on it for a little while and just kind of play around with different tools. You really kind of, any little changes that you make, you just find that you get a bit of an adrenaline rush because it just starts to make a whole lot, it can look so much better, which is a slight change. And
I'm having trouble believing, just thinking about what you first showed us when you started in Photoshop to what it is now.
Yeah, and the thing is, like, I'm doing this in such a short period of time. Like, normally I'll spend longer and be able to kind of fine-tune each curve layer, but I just wanted to get the point across that there's so much in your data that's available that needs to be taken advantage of. And just remember, so do your curve stretches, and don't go too crazy so that your noise gets out of control. This is a little bit out of control. Right.
Also, you didn't. You only talked about bringing it into Camera Raw to do some noise reduction.
Yeah, exactly.
So that you would do that, and then you would bring it back up into the Nick and try more.
Yeah, exactly. I would do the Camera Raw filter first, and then Nick. I used to use Noise Ninja plugin a lot, but I just find Camera Raw filters just nice and easy, and it does such a great job. Especially if you combine it with layer masks, it'll give you that full control that you need. The other thing too is always remember not to darken your background so it's completely black, because the more black it is, the more you're gonna lose a lot.
Yeah, you lose detail that the dust that you brought out would be gone if you moved it.
Yeah, exactly. So you just kind of got to get used to looking at astro images where they're not completely black. So, I mean, I might darken it just a little bit more here.
Yeah.
You know, and always remember to do Shift, Control, Alt, and E, because as you're doing your layer curve stretches, you're going to start to see combing in the histogram, and it's going to look, it's going to be very 8-bit like with, you know, with your with the image. So do that, and then all of a sudden things will look fine again.
Yeah. Well, I really got to say, just you've given us a ton of great information. I really do. I think it would be great to have you back just to go over the post-processing portion of this and show us in a little more detail exactly what this breakdown is and a couple of more tricks. But for now, I think we're well past an hour and a half.
So oh, for sure, yeah.
We're going to kind of cut it off there, and everyone in the chat is saying that they want your ebook. When's your ebook coming out?
Oh goodness!
It's something to consider. I'm sure.
My kids get older.
Yeah.
I tell you, kids really really stop you from doing a lot of these things. I mean, they're wonderful, but
yeah,
like there's only so much time.
But yeah, I know. You've got a full-time job.
One thing I want to do though is because I'm so afraid of the camera, or you know, I'm getting used to it now. But I wanted to start some YouTube videos and just see where I could go with that. You know, get used to the camera and kind of give some more tutorials here and there.
Put up a GoPro with it and do some behind the scenes stuff too, you know.
Yeah.
What you're doing.
Yeah, I want to do like a, you know, a time lapse too of the processing. I think that would look kind of cool. Yeah.
That would look cool.
Yeah. Oh, also I just wanted to add one more thing. So once you're finished processing in Photoshop, I do actually bring it into Lightroom, like import it as the PSD file. I save it as a PSD file and I import it in Lightroom, and then I do my final edits in there, like before I publish to web. So I might use a tiny bit more light noise reduction in there. I might warm it up a little bit, like with these unmodified DSLR cameras. I just find like sometimes the images just look a little bit on the cool side, you know. So if you just add a little bit of warmth without compromising the star colors, might look good too. So anyways, that's all I had to add.
Okay.
Great.
Well, that's incredible, really.
Yeah.
I'm going to be going back to this one over and over and over again. I got my son and his girlfriend beside too watching, and they're in awe and laughing at the comments in the chat. So it's a family affair tonight.
Well, thanks for having me on the show.
Yeah, and thank you for joining. And I see Daryl's been kind of bouncing back in and out. I think we've lost all our stability tonight.
Yes, I know.
And thank everyone for tuning in. And I might even post this up in two parts, but we'll see.
Yeah. Oh, dear. Yeah, sorry about that.
No, I knew it was
feeling this was going to go overboard.
We knew ahead of time this was going to happen, so it's okay.
Yeah.
No problem at all. Thank you for sharing all that great knowledge with us.
Yeah, okay. Thanks a lot.
Okay.
See you later. Bye.
Bye.